Dear friends, welcome to InQuest, in-depth analysis and to the point. In this video, let us discuss about current affairs of 1st October 2021. And this activity is useful for your UPSC, KPSC and all other competitive examinations. Dear friends, the content that we will be discussing here will be given in the form of a PDF in the description box. You may also download the same after watching the video. So before getting into the news in depth, let us see the index of today's discussion. Number one, Swachh Bharat Mission Urban 2.0 and Amrut 2.0 launched. So in this article, we will be learning about the objectives of this mission and impacts of both the missions. Next article is about spent fuel storage cleared for Kudankulam 3 and 4. So these are the power plants which are there in India. So already the power plants, the nuclear power plants number 1 and 2 are in operation. Now the next two power plants, that is 3 and 4, they got clearance for their spent fuel dumping or storage. Number three, Niti Aayog launched a state nutrition profile. So in this article, we will be learning about the objectives of this state nutrition profile. Article number four, we will be talking about Jal Jeevan Mission, where 5 crore tap water connections provided since this mission is launched. Article number five, Senior Care Aging Growth Engine, that is in short called as SAGE project, to support India elderly. So in this article, we will be learning about various objectives of this particular, senior care aging growth engine. Article number six is related to Ministry of Science and Technology. So they have come up with a new development, that is unique technology for direct generation of hydrogen from agricultural residue. So from agricultural residue, they have come out with a technology to produce hydrogen. This can be used as a fuel in various industries that is going to impact positively to our global warming greatly. So now let us discuss each and every article in detail. Number one, PM launched Swachh Bharat Mission and Urban 2.0 and Amrut 2.0 on 1st October 2021. Now in this article, we will be learning about everything, all the objectives and the impact of these two particular missions. Amrut 2.0 means Atal Mission for Rejuvenation and Urban Transformation. Now let's see the objectives of both the missions. SBMU Urban 2.0 and Amrut 2.0 have been designed to realize the aspirations to make all our cities garbage free and water secure. So the major purpose of SBMU 2.0 to maintain or to have clearance with respect to garbage in the cities, and Amrut 2.0 majorly takes care about water. And the main purpose of this is effectively addressing the challenges of rapidly urbanizing India, and will also help contribute towards achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals 2030. Now let's know more about Swachh Bharat Mission Urban 2.0. So as I told you, so this is envisioned to make all cities garbage free and ensure gray and black water management in all cities other than those that are covered under Amrut. So apart from the cities that come under Amrut, all other cities will be under SBMU 2.0. Here they majorly manage gray and black water. So gray water in the sense that is any water that is used in kitchen purpose, washing and bathing. So that is relatively less toxic. But black water is it is difficult to reuse black water, because this water is the water used in toiletries like flushing water, urinals and etc. So this SBMU 2.0 is mainly intended to manage gray and black water in the cities, apart from those cities that are covered under Amrut, and to make all urban local bodies as ODF plus. Now, what is ODF plus? ODF plus is nothing but a city or a ward or a circle where not even a single person is defecating in open, and there are well-maintained, functional and well-maintained community or public toilets. That's called as ODF plus, and those with a population of less than 1 lakh as ODF double plus. Now ODF double plus is nothing but there is proper maintenance of sludge and septate. That's called as ODF plus, thereby achieving the vision of safe sanitation in urban areas. The mission will focus on source segregation of solid waste. So what are the things that they are going to focus under this mission? So source segregation of solid waste, utilizing the principles of 3 R's, that is reduce, reuse, and recycle, scientific processing of all types of municipal solid waste, and remediation of legacy dump sites for effective solid waste management. And the outlay of SBMU 2.0 is around 1.41 lakh crore. Now with this, let's learn more about AMRUT 2.0. AMRUT 2.0 aims to provide 100% coverage of water supply to all households in around 4,700 urban local bodies by providing about 2.68 crore tap connections. So this is the, you know, aim of this particular mission, to provide 2.68 crore tap connections and 100% coverage of sewerage and septage in 15 Amrut cities by providing around 2.64 crore sewer or septate connections, which will benefit more than 10.5 crore people in urban areas. AMRUT 2.0 will adopt the principles of circular economy. Circular economy is different from linear economy, where there is more importance given to recycle, and promote conservation and rejuvenation of surface and groundwater bodies. The mission will promote data-led governance in water management and technology, submission to leverage latest global technologies and skills. Pejal Sarvekshan will be conducted to promote progressive competition among the cities. The outlay of AMRUT 2.0 is around 2.87 lakh crore. So as I told you initially, Swachh Bharat Urban 2.0 majorly takes care about sanitation, and AMRUT 2.0 majorly takes care about, water management. So what is the impact of these two missions? So let us see the impact that is created by both the missions. So SBMU and AMRUT have contributed significantly to improve urban landscape during the last 7 years. The two flagship missions have augmented the capacity to deliver basic services of water supply and sanitation to those citizens. Swachh Bharat has become a Jan Andolan today. All urban local bodies have been declared open defecation free, and 70% solid waste is being scientifically processed now. So this is a very good achievement. So almost all urban local bodies have been declared open defecation free, and 70% of the solid waste now has been scientifically processed. AMRUT has been ensuring water security by adding 1.1 crore household water tap connections and 85 lakh sewer connections, thus benefiting more than 4 crore people. So this is the impact of both the missions so far. So with this, let's go to article number 2. Spent fuel storage cleared for Kudankulam units 3 and 4. So there will be use of radioactive substances as a fuel for electricity generation in nuclear power points. Power plants. So once the radioactive substance is used, so this radioactive substances, after their usage, so they will be hazardous. So this hazardous radioactive substances should be dumped appropriately. So now for the dumping of these radioactive hazardous fuel, that is after usage, so Kudankulam units 3 and 4 have got clearance. So let's see who has given this clearance and who will be responsible for dumping these particular radioactive substances without creating any hazard. So the Atomic Energy Regulatory Body, in short called as AERB, has granted consent for the establishment of away from reactor spent fuel storage for Kudankulam nuclear power projects unit 3 and 4. So dumping should be done away from the reactors. The consent will be valid for 5 years from August 23rd, 2021, the date of issuance. So the date of issuance is on in the month of August, that is 23rd, 2021. So from this date, the validity is for 5 years. Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited, that is in short called as NPCIL, had proposed away from reactor storage for units 3 and 4 on the existing site. So dumping will be done in the existing site only, but it should be done away from the reactor, where 2 into 1000 megawatt units, 1 and 2 are in operation, and the 4 into 1000 megawatt units, 3 to 6 are in various stages of construction. So the 1 and 2 power plants are already in operation, and various from 3 to 6 units are there in various stages of its development. The primary, now who is the who has taken the responsibility, or who should be taking the responsibility of this harmless dumping? That is, the primary responsibility for safety of the facility is rested with NPCIL, that is Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited. The criteria for evaluation of a site for locating a particular nuclear facility was to ensure that the site-plant interaction did not result in radiological impact beyond the limit prescribed by AERB, and the site was engineered to handle external hazard. So this is about the clearance given to Kudankulam units 3 and 4. Now let us learn the basic information about Kudankulam. So Kudankulam nuclear plant is the largest nuclear power station in India, situated in Kudankulam in Tirunelveli district of southern Indian state of Tamil Nadu. So this is largest nuclear power station in India. So very important point. So construction on the plant began on 31st March 2002, but faced several delays due to opposition from local fishermen. So there was a lot of opposition from local fishermen because, the nuclear, the radioactive substances are going to be hazardous to human beings or anything. Kudankulam nuclear power plant is scheduled to have 6 VVER. VVER in the sense water energy generator, water energy reactor, 1000 reactors built in collaboration with. So this is actually built in collaboration with Russia. So the Russian state company is Atomstory Export. This is the Russian state company, and Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited, that is NPCIL, with an installed capacity of 6,000 megawatts of electricity. So this is done in collaboration with Russia, basically. So this is the Kudankulam power plant. And to look at the map here, so Tamil Nadu is here, and we have to the south of Tamil Nadu. That is almost to the southernmost of Tamil Nadu, or even in case southernmost of India, we have Kudankulam nuclear power plant in the map. So what is the design and specification of the power plant? The reactors are pressurized water reactor of Russian design, model VVER 1000 or V412, referred as AES-92. The thermal capacity is 3000 megawatts. So thermal capacity is 3000 megawatts, and gross electrical capacity is 1000 megawatts with a net capacity of 917 megawatts. Construction is by NPCIL and Atomstory Export of Russia. Both units are water cooled and water moderated power reactors. Now, how the operations are done? The first reactors of the plant, when did these two power plants become operational? The first reactor, so let's talk about first reactor. The first reactor of the plant attained criticality on 13 July 2013. Criticality is the process, somewhere the midway of these nuclear reactors. So it attained criticality on 13 July 2013 and was connected to the grid 3 months later. So it started commercial operations from 31st December 2014. So this date is important. So when the first reactor of Kudankulam got into operation, that is 31st December 2014. And the second unit achieved its criticality on 10th July 2016. So roughly around 3 years from the criticality attained by first reactor, and was connected to the grid in August Commercial operations started on 15th October 2016, roughly for about 2 years after the operationalization of the first reactor. So these are the status of first and second units. The Kerala State Electricity Board, in short called as KSEB, board members have approved signing of power purchase agreement with the Nuclear Power Corporation of India, NPCIL, for sourcing electricity from Kudankulam Nuclear Power Project, KKNPP. So that is, the Kerala government has already made an MOU to buy the electricity from these power plants. Now, this is the entire summary of the power plants. So there are two phases, phase one and phase two. So phase one power plants are already in operation. That is Kudankulam Nuclear Power Plant 1 and 2. And everything, all the reactors that are used in Kudankulam are principled on VVER, water, energy generator 1000 works on this particular principle. And this is when the construction started. This is when the operation started. So the first two units are in operation on these two dates. And plants from 3 to 6 are at different levels of their construction. And you can see their anticipated dates of operationalization. So you can just pause the video and look for all the details and everything of the capacity. All the plants are of the capacity 1000 megawatts. So with this, let's move on to the next article. So here the article is related to Niti Aayog. So they've launched the state nutrition profile for 19 states and union territories. So in this article, we will be learning about the objectives and purpose of this state nutrition profile. So let's see the article in detail. Niti Aayog, in a joint effort with International Food Policy Research Institute, IFPRI, Indian Institute of Population Sciences, IIPS, UNICEF, and Institute of Economic Growth, IEG, launched the state nutrition profiles for 19 states and union territories on 30th September 2021. And this is tight, So this was actually launched on a webinar. So that was titled as Towards Progress on Nutrition in India, Insights from National Family Health Survey Phase 1 organized by IFPRI. Now let's see the purpose of this particular program. The state nutrition profiles, you should remember SNP because we will be using this term again and again in this article, that is state nutrition profiles, give insights on nutrition outcomes, immediate and underlying determinants and interventions based on NFHS rounds 3, 4, and 5. So NFHS is nothing but National Family Health Survey, rounds 3, 4, and 5. The SNP, as I told you, state nutrition profiles include a comprehensive compilation of crucial data that can positively affect policy decisions and facilitate research in the area. So basically, they're going to do nutrition profiles across various districts. So this is going to help us take, positive effect on policy decisions to make policy decisions regarding nutrition. So this survey is going to be beneficial. The trend analysis of key indicators such as wasting. Wasting is nothing but, somebody who's, weight for age is less. And stunting is something where their height for their age is less than the standard height. Then anemia, it is lack of blood, particularly less number of red blood cells is called as anemia, and underweight and overweight and non-communicable diseases like diabetes and high blood pressure showcase the variability of performance across districts. The reports highlight the best and the worst performing districts, highest burden districts and top coverage districts of the country. So they're going to highlight the best and the worst and the highest burden districts and the top coverage districts of the country. The SNPs, that is state nutrition profiles, are based on the headcount based analysis. So this is done on the headcount-based analysis and use of data from NFHS5 to provide evidence that helps identify priority districts and number of districts in the state with public health concern as per WHO guidelines. So they're going to identify the states which are worst performing. So that can be taken as a priority to, you know, create policies to, you know, counter those particular deficiencies. So this is about this program or the survey. With this, let's go move on to next article. So this is with respect to Ministry of Jal Shakti, over 5 crore tap water connections provided since announcement of Jal Jeevan Mission. So let's see more about this. Since the announcement of JJM in August 2019, in just about 25 months, over 5 crore families have been provided with tap water connections in their home. So this is an achievement of 5 crore connections given, or 5 crore families have been provided with tap water connection. Assured tap water supply in homes relieves people. So what is the advantage of this basically? So the assured water supply is going to relieve people, especially women and young girls, from fetching water, carrying heavy loads at a distance, etc., thus reducing their age-old drudgery. Drudgery is a kind of a, you know, any work that is hard or difficult. The newfound time is being used for income generation activities, learning new skills, support children's education, etc. So the time saved can be used for various productive actions or productive activities, as we mentioned here. Now, let's know more about Jal Jeevan Mission. Jal Jeevan Mission was announced by Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi on 15th August 2019 to provide functional household tap connection, in short called as FHTC, to every home by 2024. So they have a target to achieve to give functional household tap connection to every home by 2024. In 2019, out of 18.93 crore households in rural area, only 3.23 crore, that is amount to 17%, had tap water connection. Thus, 15.70 crore households are to be provided with tap water connection by 2024. In addition, functionality of all existing water supply system and tap connections is also to be ensured. The program directly benefits more than 19 crore rural families. So this is of great impact with respect to this program, because 19 crore rural families are going to be benefited. So bridging rural and urban divide and improving public health. As on date, about 8.26 crore, that is 43% of the rural households, have tap water supply in their homes. The motto of Jal Jeevan Mission is that no one is left out. So to make sure that no one is left out, so this program is launched to take care of the families that do not have the functional household tap connections. Every rural household in 78 districts and 1.16 lakh villages is getting tap water supply. So following a bottom-up approach, so the execution of this program goes on this way, that is bottom-up approach. That's nothing but it starts from the ground level, like Gram Panchayat and its subcommittees. So JGM is being implemented as a decentralized, demand-driven and community-managed program with Gram Panchayats or its subcommittees, that is Village Water Sanitation Committees, in short called as WSC, Pani Samiti, is playing a key role in planning, implementation, management, operation and maintenance of in-village water system, supply system, thereby providing clean tap water to every household on regular and long-term basis. The Pani Samitis, or VWSCs, that is Village Water and Sanitation Committees, function as a legal entity as envisaged in the 73rd Amendment to the Constitution. It consists of 10 to 15 members with at least 50% women members and proportionate representation from weaker section as well. So this Village Water and Sanitation Committees prepared a one-time village action plan, in short called as VAP, co-terminus with 15th Finance Commission period by dovetailing different resources at village level. So dovetailing is something which is available easily. different resources, that means the resources that are available at villages, which is to be approved in Gram Sabha. VAP comprises of four key components of drinking water source augmentation, number one, then drinking water supply system, number two, and grey water treatment and its reuse, it is number three, and regular operation and maintenance of in-village water supply, number four. So these are the four key components of village water and sanitation committee's functions. With this, let's go to the next article, Senior Care Aging Growth Engine Project to support India's elderly. So this is this comes under Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, that is MOSJE. So what is the significance of this or importance of this particular program? So there is a sharp rise in India's elderly population, and the thrust is on creating an ecosystem that supports their needs more holistically. So since there is sharp rise in India's elderly population, to support their needs, so this program has been launched. So there are 110 million elders, that is equal to 11 crore elders in this country, who are above the age of 60 years. As per the latest industry reports, the share of elders as a percentage of total population in the country is expected to increase from 7.5% in 2001. So it was 7.5% in 2001 to almost 12.5% by 2016. So by 2016, so the elderly population is going to increase to 12.5% and surpass 19.5% by 2050. So by 2050, it is going to be 12.5%. So since there is increase in the number of old age people in the country, so this mission is, or program is, designed to support their needs. So what are the objectives? It is mainly to focus on addressing the needs of India's fast rising elderly population, to select, support, and create one-stop access of elderly care products and services. So it is to provide just one stop, it's kind of one-stop solution for all their products and services, to encourage the selected startups based on the innovative products and services, address the service from health, housing, care centers, technology access linked to needs ranging from finances, food, wealth management to legal guidance. So all these areas are going to be taken care of. And what are the outcomes expected of this? SAGE project aims to identify, evaluate, verify, aggregate, and deliver products, solutions, services, which can be directly provided to the stakeholders, giving them wide choice to select the product, solutions, and services that would suit their requirements and help in improving their quality of life. So this is the main outcome that is expected of this particular project. The Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment will act as the facilitator in the entire process, enabling the elderly to access the credible products through these identified startups. So this is, the entire activity will be taken care by Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. So the last article of today's discussion is related to Ministry of Science and Technology. So there is a development of technology, that is unique technology for direct generation of hydrogen from agricultural residue. So recently there was an article which we actually read a few days ago, wherein the hydrogen was generated from sunlight and water. So this is one more advancement to that. So wherein the hydrogen will be generated from agricultural residue. Now, what is the importance of hydrogen? It is actually called as a green fuel. It can be used as, used in various industries that can avoid using of coal for hydrogen generation. That in turn going to help us reduce carbon emission. That in turn helps us reduce global warming. So this innovation by Indian researchers can promote eco-friendly hydrogen fuel cell electric vehicles. So this can be very well used for fuel cell electric vehicles, by overcoming the challenge of hydrogen availability. India has set a target of 60% renewable energy of about 4.50 gigawatt by 2030. See, our target is to produce at least 60% of the renewable energy, that is about 450 gigawatt by 2030. To achieve this feat, in the current scenario, researchers all over the world are working towards renewable energy solutions, which should be sustainable with a limited carbon footprint. So basically, the renewable energy or any, you know, innovation or anything that is used to produce energy should not produce carbon. So that is the main objective of this. One of the most economical ways is to achieve is to produce hydrogen from a cheap, abundant and renewable sources. Now, what is that? That is nothing but agricultural waste. So which faces a great challenge of disposal. Already there is a problem of agricultural, you know, waste disposal, because you might have heard various places wherein stubble burning is one of the major causes of pollution in the country. So if we use this agricultural waste, so the two dual problems can be solved. One, disposal will be, you know, solved. Other way, we can also produce energy out of it. So disposal could be one of the, you know, this could be one of the sources of hydrogen production, and this could solve the dual problem of energy generation and also waste disposal. So this is the, one of the greatest advantages of this particular conversion. Who has done this actually? A team of researchers from Agarkar Research Institution, Pune, an autonomous institute of the Department of Science and Technology, DST, Government of India, in collaboration with sentient labs of KPIT Technologies, have developed this technology at lab scale to extract hydrogen from agricultural residues. So this actually, the department that comes under Government of India, that's called as Agarkar Research Institute, that is in Pune, and it is the Department of Science and Technology. So it is in collaboration with KPIT or KPIT Technologies. So they have come up with lab scale, you know, extraction of hydrogen. So this has to go big in the industrial scale. So right now they have developed it in the lab scale. The technology is 25% more efficient as compared to the conventional anaerobic digestion process used today. So the technology that is in use today already, so the new technology of conversion agricultural waste to hydrogen is 25% more efficient. That's very good number. This two-stage process eliminates the pre-treatment of biomass. So there's no need to pre-treat the biomass, because it is just a two-stage process, thus making the process economical and environment friendly. So the process is both economical and this is also economic friendly. So we can achieve both, increase in economy in the country. At the same time, we can strike a balance between both economy and environment. This process generates a digestate that is rich in nutrients. So the one of the advantages again is, the process is going to produce a digestate, and the quality of this digestate is, this is rich in nutrients, which can be used as an organic fertilizer once again. So there is no waste produced here. This is kind of a circular process. The process generates hydrogen in the first stage. So in the first stage, hydrogen is going to be generated, and then later it is going to produce, first stage, and methane in the second stage. So in the second stage, it is going to produce methane. But this methane is again used to generate the additional hydrogen later. So nothing is wasted here. The first stage, what these we are going to get is hydrogen directly. At the same time, we're going to get methane also in the second stage. But the methane that is produced in the second stage can be used once again to produce hydrogen. So this increases the yield or quantity of hydrogen that is going to be produced by this process. So this breakthrough of generating hydrogen from unutilized agricultural residue will help us to become self-reliant on energy resources. So we can become self-reliant on energy resources. It will also add a major stream of revenue to farmer community. So this is going to help farmers. So we can, we are witnessing a lot of suicides in the farmers in India. to some extent, this is going to help them if this is, you know, commercially or this is, you know, started in the industrial scale. Right now, it is in the lab scale. So this is one of the greatest advantages that can be provided to our farmers community. So these are all the articles of today's discussion. If you have any questions, you may put in comments box. We are more than happy to answer to your questions. Thanks for watching. Namaskara.